I'm Bill Stone, CEO for Stone Aerospace in Austin, Texas. I'd like to relate to you today some things we've learned from robotic exploration of subterranean cavities on Earth and how those lessons might apply to the exploration of planetary lava tubes. Recent orbital images have shown clear presence of lava tube skylights on the Moon and Mars. There are obvious uses for such places since they represent potential human habitat sites with isothermal temperatures and free radiation and meteorite shielding. So, how do you explore a lava tube skylight? On Earth, it's pretty straightforward. You get a rope, a harness, and rappel in. But don't make any bets on that being a realistic exploration procedure on Mars. One way we could safely recon such places is with a hovering drone, but currently lift mass is an issue, and that will also be a problem on Mars until 3D mapping instrumentation is miniaturized. So we decided to investigate an analog environment here on Earth to test subterranean exploration autonomy. We've built three subsurface AUVs for NASA, all of which had to solve problems like navigation, guidance, and control where there is no GPS, and to perform critical maneuvers like rendezvous, docking, and recovery through a drilled shaft and an ice cap, not much larger in diameter than the vehicle. This sounds a lot like a Martian lava tube mission. This is Sunfish, a person-portable 6-degree of freedom AUV developed at our lab over the last decade. The main advance made by Sunfish over the last 4 years has been in fully autonomous behavior-based exploration in overhead environments. Sunfish is arguably one of the most intelligent underwater vehicles on this planet. It flies like a fighter, hovers like a helicopter, and performs acrobatic maneuvers like no other underwater vehicle. Unlike existing planetary robotic systems, Sunfish uses behavior-based AI to explore, not scripting. We initially tested our exploration behavior ideas in an underwater labyrinth in Florida. Here's a view of the same scene, but within the data space of the robot. At the heart of the exploration process is situational awareness. We start by building a 3D model of the world around the vehicle. We then calculate a vector that the vehicle can move along to create the greatest amount of new knowledge while not violating obstacle avoidance and other mission failure criteria. The white sections that you see here represent those vectors of allowed transit while not violating obstacle avoidance criteria. And it will finish here in just a second. So that same data can then be converted post-mission to a meshed fly-through. And this is that same Florida labyrinth that was just mapped by Sunfish in the previous video. This is roughly 160 meters worth of traverse here. The tunnel itself is at a depth of about 20 meters. The average passage width is on the order of 10 to 15 meters. And it's going to end up here at 160 meters from the entrance. So to recap what I've shown so far, exploration behavior in a simple morphology like a lava tube can be accomplished with a stepwise procedure as shown here. There are, of course, many other constraints that are operating in parallel, but the main issues are the determination of where to go to learn more about the unknown and not running into anything while you're doing that. So, what happens when it's time to get back and report to mission control? Here is a video. This is the same section of tunnel, but we're looking down in plan view now, and the vehicle is making these sweeps in 3D, creating the point cloud map of the tunnel that you see right here. This is greatly sped up, of course. Roughly, this was a 1-hour and 10-minute mission for it to make a round trip here. What you'll see here in just a minute, though, is that it will come up around the bend and then begin to go home. So here we are, just about there. And now we're coming home. You'll notice that it's moving a lot faster here. And that is the important part that I'm going to talk about next year. We're just going to go ahead and let this video finish out. The white sections that you see being created are the allowed traversability. And as you get into better known tunnel with less bends, it makes bigger jumps. And we'll come on to that here in just a second. So what happened in that video? The Sunfish vehicle currently scans and moves in straight lines. Each time a scan is performed, it generates an obstacle map at that waypoint and records it. The set of all obstacle maps are used to hypothesize which waypoints are visible from each other. Each time the map is updated, the optimization recalculates all of the waypoint positions using PoseGraph optimization and reevaluates which waypoints are visible from all others. We call this a traversability graph. Sunfish uses this traversability graph to plot a course back home. And in general, we've seen 5-10 times faster returns than during the inbound exploration. Once we had these autonomous exploration behaviors tested, the next step was to do it for real in a completely unknown, unexplored subterranean aquifer. We spent a month in Namibia in the heart of the Kalahari Desert. Our first test was at a site called Lake Aguinas, which turned out to be a karst cenote. It reaches a depth of 133 meters underwater. It's got an hourglass-shaped chamber. It's more than 400 meters from left to right in this image and 200 meters in width into the page. Sunfish created this entire map in one mission. Our next stop was Haraseeb Shaft. This is a 112-meter freefall pit coming from the surface down to water level at a water-filled shaft that goes straight down. From a floating raft, we deployed Sunfish, and it dove vertically to a depth of 150 meters before discovering a horizontal extension. We explored over 500 meters horizontally into the submerged cave at Haraseeb, reaching a depth of 265 meters underwater before the cavern ended. The newly discovered chamber in the middle measures more than 100 meters tall and 80 meters wide and continues for over 300 meters with a very rugged breakdown floor. Those dimensions are big in any cave on Earth. Here is a fly-through of the Haraseeb data produced by Sunfish. The first part, right until it gets very fine here, was produced by LiDAR. The next two-thirds of the data were done with multi-beam sonar carried by Sunfish down to an absolute depth of 387 meters below the surface. And it, again, ends with a breakdown collapse at the end. Our final target was Dragon's Breath Cave. It has a rather inauspicious small entrance located in this karst field in a valley. But 60 meters straight down, it opens out into the world's largest known subterranean lake. That lake measures over 200 meters long and 125 meters wide. And it's very deceptive in its size when you're in there. It takes a long time to row a boat across that room. We again established a floating launch base for Sunfish. The vehicle carried a 4-kilometer data fiber, which was paid out from an axial drum so that we could observe its progress and the real-time decisions being made by the robot. Although this term is properly supervised autonomy, Sunfish made all the exploration decisions by itself and used its just created maps to return home. So this really was a completely autonomous mission by the robot. This is a profile view showing the primary tunnel in Dragon's Breath, which reaches a depth of 205 meters underwater. Here's a plan view of the same cave showing the primary tunnel. And in this particular case, the black line that you see in a polygon shape there on the left, that's the open lake surface, and then the underwater tunnel proceeds to the right. It reaches a width of 175 meters by 80 meters tall in cross-section, which is truly enormous for any cave on Earth. and proceeds to the north for more than 500 meters before the passage pinches down and ends. And here is a quick fly around the cave. This is a volume underwater of 2.5 million cubic meters. And then this tiny little section up here at the top is the entrance shaft series coming down. In all, Sunfish autonomously mapped more than 4 million cubic meters of previously unknown subterranean aquifer. The lessons learned on these missions directly apply to the exploration of lunar and Martian lavatubes, since they are morphologically similar. The code we developed is readily transferable to drone platforms with minor instrument changes. The research was supported by Stone Aerospace, the National Geographic Society, and the Schmidt Marine Technology Partners Foundation. Thank you.